Good afternoon, everyone. It's now officially afternoon, I guess, by a couple of minutes. I hope everyone was able to grab some lunch. There's more food out there, so feel free if you want another sandwich, coffee refill. Help yourself. My name, for those of you who don't know me, is Ian Wilson. I'm a professor of religious studies here, and I also direct the Chester Ronning Center for the Study of Religion and Public Life, which is hosting this event today. Before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge that the land on which we gather, traditionally known as Siniscao Sapesis or Stony Creek, is Treaty 6 territory and a traditional meeting ground for many indigenous peoples. The land on which this campus, the Augustana campus, is located provided a traveling route and home to the Musqueaches, Nihayawak, Nitsitapa, Nakota, and Tsuut'ina nations, the Métis, and other indigenous peoples. Their spiritual and practical relationships to the land create a rich heritage for our learning here at Augustana and for our life as a community here in Camrose, so I'd like to acknowledge that. Our guest today is Dr. Darren Dochuk, who is from the University of Notre Dame, and he's this semester's Distinguished Visiting Fellow at the Ronning Center. Darren is an associate professor in the history department at Notre Dame, and before working there, he held academic posts at Purdue, at Southern Methodist University in Texas, and at Washington University in St. Louis, among other institutions. For those of you who were here or at Darren's talk last night at the public library, you will know, though, that he's also a Canadian and that he grew up in Edmonton, right here in Alberta, and was educated at Canadian universities, including Simon Fraser in BC and Queen's University in Ontario. Most recently, he is the author of this book, Anointed with Oil: How Christianity and Crude Made Modern America, which was published just this year by Basic Books and which is available for purchase at the bookstore. Because he grew up around here, he's been thinking about these issues for pretty much his entire life. And he researched this book for, I think, over a decade. So it's a monumental work, a very important work. I won't steal any more of his time or his thunder, but in the book, he looks very closely at the intimate relationship between the oil industry and Christianity, and examines how different Christian theologies have played into the development of different capitalistic ethics in the oil industry world, and vice versa, how different capitalistic ethics have informed Christian theology in that context. So today he's going to talk to us some more about his work on these issues. So please join me in welcoming Darren to speak.
Hey, thanks, Ian. Thank you. Thanks, Ian, and thank you, Diane and Catherine and the Ronning Center and the University of Alberta for this warm welcome. I have greatly enjoyed my brief visit here, and we'll look forward to meeting a few more of you today and chatting with you. Certainly, if you have questions, we're going to spend some time conversing about religion and oil. Religion and oil, and especially the politics of religion and oil, and there's just a bit of that going on around here. So it is, I'm sure, timely and hopefully relevant. I, of course, have worn my Alberta citizenship on my sleeve this visit, and it's been good to be back. But I have been struck, as I said yesterday, how the kind of dynamics never seem to change a whole lot. I grew up here in the 1980s, and some of the same questions and issues seem to be rising once again in Alberta's politics. So yesterday I had a chance to focus more on Alberta than I will today, although Alberta will factor in just briefly. And again, I'm happy to discuss what this province's role has been in my story. But today I will focus mostly on the U.S. and dynamics of religion and oil and the politics of the two through the 20th century, especially the heart of the 20th century in the United States. And again, my overarching theme for today and for the book is that oil is not just a commodity around businessmen and politicians' rally or the economic lifeblood for oil patch communities. It really is an imprint on America's, and I would add Alberta's, soul. And as we proceed, I hope you'll see just how that is and perhaps with what implications and at what cost? So my focus for the next few minutes will be on the long history of oil and religion in the U.S. And I think an appropriate starting place is a televised speech that President Jimmy Carter delivered exactly 40 years ago this summer. How many of you remember seeing this? Anyone? Well, it was known as the Crisis of Confidence speech, later dubbed the Malaise speech. And it was certainly one of the most, if not the most important, of Jimmy Carter's career, as it came at a precipitous time amid revolution in Iran, of course, and the resulting second energy crisis of the 1970s. With a seriousness that emanated out from the large bureau at which he sat, he pleaded for people to support his energy conservation agenda. But the speech turned into much more than that. As I was preparing to speak, he explained, I began to ask myself the same questions that I now know has been troubling many of you. Why have we not been able to get together as a nation to resolve our serious energy problem? It's clear that the true problems of our nation are much deeper. And here he slammed his fist on the desk before him. Deeper than gasoline lines or energy shortages, deeper even than inflation or recession. Then he singled out the culprit. It is a crisis of confidence. It is a crisis that strikes at the very heart and soul and spirit of our national will. We can see this crisis in the growing doubt about the meaning of our own lives and in the loss of a unity of purpose for our nation. Carter ended with a pledge of hope. In the days to come, let us renew that strength in the struggle for an energy-secure nation. Let us commit ourselves together to a rebirth of the American spirit. Of course, those of you who are aware of Carter's career as president, and it was a short one, will know that he spoke several times on energy, including opening up really his presidency in April 1977, in which he charged that the fight for renewable energies and energy conservation was, quote, the moral equivalent of war. And those of you who perhaps are aware of the speech that he delivered in 1979, from which I just quoted, will know that many of his advisors advised him against giving such a speech. They warned that sermonizing to the American people would do the opposite, that it would merely kind of reaffirm their lack of confidence in his presidency. But Carter did not budge. And the main takeaways of the 1979 Crisis of Confidence speech remained his and one of his advisors to make. And first, that the U.S. had lost confidence in itself and its global standing. And two, that the crisis wasn't just energy related, it was a moral crisis as well. So Carter's speech is an appropriate entry point as it gets to the heart of some of my book's core questions, two of which are simply this. How did oil get grafted onto the soul of American society and serve as a catalyst for its political, economic, and religious ambitions on a global stage, paving the way for the American century? And what happened and what did it mean for this nation when the confidence of an American century fueled by big religion and big oil crumbled during the energy crisis of the Carter years? In an effort to just kind of give you a glimpse, a snapshot today, we don't have time to get in too deep to the texture, the material that I offer, but today I'll offer you just a glimpse at a couple of facets of what I deem a religious biography of oil, with focus, as I suggested earlier, on the mid-20th century, kind of the 1930s to the 1960s, with, of course, a brief discussion of the 1970s. I hope that this snapshot will prompt us to think about how oil has organized American, North American life so profoundly at different altitudes of religious experience and political struggle. I'll begin by glancing at how American power brokers imagined oil's seemingly divine potentials and attached them to a faith and politics of exceptionalism on a global stage. I'll then cut briefly to the local level, one local oil patch of great importance, and that being East Texas. And there I'll just detail in brief the unique practices of faith and fuel values that evolved on that oil patch with ramifications for American politics to the present day. And then I'll finish by summarizing a few legacies of these crude awakenings, particularly in a modern American politics, again, many of which we are still living with today. Petroleum achieved unprecedented status between the 1930s and 60s as leverage for America's authority in the hydrocarbon age. But it first captured America's soul in the 19th century as the fuel and lubricant that would light its cities and grease its modern machinery and economic ascent. To be sure, amid America's excited rush into modernity, other natural resources inspired sacred dreams of their own, most notably, of course, coal, which for both the British and the Americans kind of stirred up their own sense of divine destiny on a global in a global arena. The coal providing them the opportunity to modernize quicker than other nations and then go out into the world and, in their estimation, Christianize a barbarous world. Yet even in the 19th century, at this early juncture, oil's sacred status was special. Summoned, not scraped from the earth, spectacular in its earth-shattering arrival, and deemed a democratic agent for the way it privileged individuals' free labor with earth's resources, oil always seemed the purer industrial lifeblood. Oil's discovery during the Civil War in western Pennsylvania, its role in aiding Union victory and setting the nation's new course, its metaphoric function of linking modern material to ancient biblical and Native American peoples, and its perceived regenerative properties, quite literally as a balm for injured soldiers in the Civil War and a healing balm for a broken society, underscored oil's salvific nature for a society on the rise. And this was abundantly evident in the popular literature of the time, which really sparkled with bold predictions of American oil's manifest destiny. And this slide has been up now. I'm sure you've had a chance to read it, but this is just one of countless that would appear in magazines throughout the United States at the turn of the 20th century, just proclaiming how American oil is a cosmopolite, omnipresent and omnipotent in the fulfilling of its grand mission of enlightening the whole universe. Again, not atypical, very typical for the time. As much as oil, U.S. oil was mythologized in biblical abstraction, it also influenced God-fearing individuals with clout, who translated Crude and Christianity's shared vision of the future into real institutional structures and policies of significance. Their efforts were certainly evident in earlier generations of the petroleum industry, but they carried special weight as the United States and its influence spread globally throughout the 20th century. Two men, both sons of missionaries, serve as illustration for us. The first is anyone know who this individual is? That's Henry Luce, a famous publisher, grew up on the Chinese mission field, and in 1941, now a very powerful publicist, owning Life magazine, Time, he wrote an article that beseeched Americans to recognize their status as protector of the free world and create, in his words, the first American century. Unbeknownst to his readers is that Luce had actually tested this charge a month earlier in an address to the American Petroleum Institute. There he praised oilmen for being the vanguards of America's expanded role in the world. Having within you a dynamic spirit of freedom and enterprise and a genius for cooperation and organization, it follows inevitably that you do not stop at the frontier of mountains or sea or jungle, nor at the man-made frontiers of knowledge or tradition or hope for your sense of the illimitable roundness of the world. I salute you. He said that in Texas or Oklahoma, I believe so. In any case, this was, again, something that he thought was unique and special to the oil industry. He was especially enamored with oil corporations that were exploring for oil at this time with more intensity across the globe, and in the process spreading modern technologies and know-how. It was at this time that the Seven Sisters, seven major oil companies, five of which were American, three of which were offshoots of the original Standard Oil, were turning their focus towards South America and the Arabian Peninsula, urged on by Washington and the White House to discover new fields and secure American hegemony before domestic reserves ran out. And there was a great fear in the 1940s that American oil domestic production was going to drop and certainly not be able to fuel the new hydrocarbon age that, of course, Americans embraced like no other. For Luce, the corporate labors of these companies conjured a sense of illimitable power, which, when harnessed by God-fearing patriots, held the capacity to transform the world into something godlier and good. America's special blessing, oil, was in his mind also its prophetic charge. He drew on metaphor to encourage his compatriots to use oil to fuel international advancement with America at the head. Scholars have proved how this nation's singular possession of petroleum served as a pillar of the American century. Luce, the architect of the very term, the notion, suggests that a religion of ecumenical outreach and global development be included as oil's twin column. A second individual pictured below, kneeling in front of Ibn Saud and Franklin D. Roosevelt in 1945, believed the same way as Luce. William A. Eddy was the son of Presbyterian missionaries in the Middle East who were part of the contingent of Western Protestants responsible for founding the American University of Beirut, which would become a key training site for engineers, oil engineers in the region throughout the late 20th century. Trained at Princeton, Eddy went on to teach at the American University in Cairo and at Dartmouth before accepting the presidency of Hobart College in 1936. By the early 40s, Eddy was a man of Protestant confidence who envisioned a new world order constructed out of enchanting crude. In 1940, while recruiting support for Hobart, he lectured on the power of God in the secular world, which implored lay people to be, quote, the shock troops of the church and to assume the, quote, super secular task of transforming each sector of the globe. We who follow Christ, he said, need to cover ourselves with tolerance, reverence, and charity, and then wherever we walk, we shall find ourselves standing on holy ground. Within months, Eddy was acting on this imperative, first serving as an officer in the Office of Strategic Services, eventually the CIA, to survey Arabia for subsurface crude, gain knowledge of its people and their faith in Allah, and bring the U.S. into union with this rising kingdom. 5 years after proclaiming allegiance to a totalitarian and tolerant Christianity, he oversaw a historic deal between Saudi's king, Ibn Saud, and America's President Roosevelt, pictured here, which basically installed the United States in this region for good. Eddy's subsequent career was testament to the potency of his liberal internationalist vision and of the key role oil would play in it. As a hired consultant for the Chevron Texaco-owned Aramco and an Arabist in political sympathy, supportive of Arab causes, as opposed to Israel and Jewish causes, for instance, he promoted peace between Western and Saudi interests, and he did so by way of mutual fiscal ambition and shared respect for the divine. And again, Aramco being today one of the most profitable companies in the world. This is the very beginning stages of Aramco, pictured here before you, and William Eddy would play a key role in kind of legitimating its role in this kind of spread of internationalism and cooperation. Through aggressive proliferation of corporate promotion, as well as practical instruction on how to live and labor in a land saturated with God and black gold, Eddy not only wrapped Aramco in a myth of enlightened capitalism and corporate benevolence, but also animated ground-level operations on the drill sites and in the oil camps with a tenor of intercultural and ecumenical exchange. And again, there's numerous examples here. I spent weeks in the papers of not just Eddy, but of several of his colleagues who were instrumental in creating an Arabian Affairs Division. These were all leading scholars, many of them sons of missionaries, trained in the language and deeply devout in their kind of respect for Muslim culture in the region, and wanting Aramco to be sensitive to that. They did that through the activities of the Arabian Affairs Division, which again facilitated cross-cultural education among workers and interaction, also encouraged encourage the spread of knowledge through their own writing, through their own speeches throughout the world on just how vital this experiment in Saudi Arabia could be for the United States as well. They also, I found very, kind of an exciting find in my research, uncovering just the extent to which they also created an infrastructure of small cell groups of Catholics, of Protestants of different ilk, of evangelicals, and encourage the interaction of these morale groups on Aramco's site. Now, they called them morale groups, of course, because religion other than Islam was not allowed technically in Saudi Arabia, but they found a way underground, really, to create an infrastructure that was vast. By the mid-50s, there were at least 5,000 Catholics involved with this, thousands of other Protestants. So there is a way in which this ecumenical exchange was also a very clear institutional infrastructure. And politically, they would also, in the 1950s, Eddie and his colleagues, on behalf of Aramco in Saudi Arabia, beseech President Eisenhower to include Islam in what Eisenhower had framed as a new Judeo-Christian America, a new tri-faith America. And I don't have time to get into it here, we can talk later perhaps, but Eisenhower, of course, quite famously envisioned the United States in the 50s, created this notion of a Judeo-Christian America, one in which Protestants, Jews, and Catholics could all be united. And for the purposes, of course, of religious freedom, celebrate that within the United States, but also project itself as a unified front against, of course, the great fear of the Cold War being secular communism. And Eddie and his colleagues lobbied for Muslims, for Islam to be part of that, for Eisenhower to create a quadrilateral. And in the 50s, at least, they would be successful. The 1960s, that vision would crumble as political divisions stirred up in the Middle East would fracture again this beyond repair. But these were some of the projects that they undertook. Eddie and Luce's sense of vocation spoke to the aspirations of a whole cadre of visionaries. Power brokers with rising influence in mid-20th century major oil and the state, they adhered to what I call a civil religion of crude, a confidence that big religion, defined as ecumenical, internationalist, civil, cosmopolitan, wedded to big oil, defined by integration, combination, multinationalism, and collective effort between state and company in foreign fields, could guarantee this nation's global authority. The linchpin of this cadre was, of course, the Rockefeller family, the first family of big oil. It was John D. Rockefeller Jr., a son to senior, who, of course, created the Rockefeller Standard Oil Empire, who came to embody the civil religion of crude by placing the profits of his family's Standard Oil Empire in the service of its broad initiatives. Frustrated with evangelistic strategies of global outreach, he built a philanthropy that stressed scientifically informed international development. In the realm of corporate relations, his influence was imprinted on the lamp. You see before you here a magazine produced by Standard New Jersey to keep laborers, workers, employees, stockholders, and a wider public inspired to advance petroleum's humanitarianism into societies of all racial composition and stages of development. Junior's sense of mission got a boost in 1940 when his five sons founded the Rockefeller Brothers Fund. Of the five, none was more important in linking oil to global economic development than Nelson Rockefeller, pictured in the top right, whose work with Inter-American Affairs placed him at the forefront of U.S. plans for development in Cold War South America. He would be trained very much in this doctrine of development, which would be embraced by Harry Truman in the late 1940s as really a key to American foreign policy. Nelson had really kind of immersed himself in this first in the 1930s while working as a head executive for Creole Oil Company in Venezuela. There, again, he noted the role that oil companies needed to play as secular missionaries, in his words, the way they needed to build communities, company towns, models of class and social relations that had very much a respect for religion as well. This is kind of the vision that Nelson had that aligned with the civil religion of crude that I've just highlighted. Nelson's agenda assumed urgency in his mind as in Eddie's, oil's beneficence and collective action on an international scale had to be exploited. lest the U.S. lost its global authority. Now, I don't want to suggest that Nelson Rockefeller was deeply devout. His father, Jr., certainly was, but the five sons, in varying degree, were less committed, if you will, to a traditional Christian gospel. But nevertheless, he was a man who longed to reshape the Southern Hemisphere in an image of Christian democracy. He believed that his civil religion of Crude would stymie communism and anti-colonialism's influences there and ensure America's place at the head of a new international order. Indeed, big oil's apostles may not have worn biblical convictions on their sleeves. They were willing to drop doctrinal insistencies for the sake of universal brotherhood and an imperial logic of service. Yet however much they were drained of its dogmatisms, oil's promise continued to inform their actions. Its solicitations to extract God's bounties from the earth with an eye to a higher being and a higher sense of being. Oil's global topographies in this way became their theological planes. Okay, that's an overview kind of one key player in my book, and that is about major oil companies and the role of the Rockefellers and the role of kind of this internationalist ecumenical religious vision. But it's just one thread in oil's biography, vital to understanding, of course, the nation's quest for global authority. As much as we must appreciate oil's hold over American power brokers, we must also appreciate the marriage of God and black gold as taking root in a peculiar local ecology. I propose that if we want to understand some of the profoundest turns in modern U.S. politics and culture, we must appreciate the outsized importance of the American oil patch itself. A landscape cohered around notions of God and black gold as omnipotent, out of which stirred an irreversible challenge to the Rockefeller, Luce gospel. There, amid the jungles of derricks and the sounds of and glow of refining fires, countless citizens stirred up with spiritual ardor interpreted petroleum as their special providence, as God's special gift to them, to be used to advance a kingdom of their making. Stated another way, residents of the oil patch have always upheld a potent carbon gospel of their own, one we call and one I call wildcat Christianity. In technical terms, wildcatter referred to oil's industrious rank and file, whose quest for crude were legitimated by mineral rights that granted any man authority to tap subsurface crude. This rule of capture, implemented at oil's very beginning in the mid-19th century, allowed them to take as much oil as they wished from wells, even if that meant draining the pool under a neighbor's property. Oil belonged to the individual who captured it, meaning it was best to drill aggressively. Now, for John D. Rockefeller Sr., founder of the Rockefeller Empire, the rule of capture was wasteful. His was a bureaucratic outlook that lined up with Max Weber's Protestant work ethic, which assumed that good capitalists would uphold rules of calculation and control. Whereas Rockefeller sought to dull oil's laissez-faire free-for-all, the small competitors, and we're talking thousands of small oil producers, who abhorred Rockefeller's monopoly in oil's first frontier of Pennsylvania, they saw in their rule of capture indelible virtues. For these wildcatters who drilled wildcat discovery wells on untapped land, that rule was sacrosanct and protected their wishes to act alone. They reveled in risk-taking and accepted the volatilities of chance and pursued profits as if there were no tomorrow. In Weber's rendering, they were warrior heroes. Wildcat Christianity also captured in sacred terms the resilient utopian expectations that accompanied their quest to drill. Amid their sector's boom-bust cycles and fluctuations of health and wealth that followed, their faith offered meaning through a theology that nurtured personal, mystical encounter with soil and an active higher being, a fierce individualism fortified by small-scale association, and notions of time that anticipated the violence of life in the oil age. At the turn of the 20th century, wildcat Christianity was forced out of its original home in the Alleghenies by Rockefeller dominance and relocated west across the Mississippi. And this just kind of maps out quickly oil's progressions. This is a story of migration. For the second half of the 19th century, of course, oil would be predominantly based in Pennsylvania, but thanks to these thousands of independent oilmen, small producers forced out by Rockefeller, they're going to move across the Mississippi, and there, to the surprise of many, as I said last night, discover oil in humongous quantities, unexpectedly so, first in Southern California, and then in South Texas at Spindletop near Beaumont in 1901, right on the coast. This is the biggest discovery ever. Up to that point, put Texas at the center of oil production on a global level. And then, of course, Oklahoma would follow. The gusher age of Texas is 1900 to 1940, allowing wildcatters, these small oil producers, many of them, countless of them, devout, radical in their beliefs in the power of the individual and of a personal faith in Christ. There, they were able to take root, and because of these discoveries, see their businesses grow, allowing them to compete with the Rockefellers in the business, but also allowing them to put their stamp on the southwestern oil patch, determining not just its corporate practices, its sense of capitalism, but also the way in which faith took shape in the pews and the pulpits of this region throughout the first half of the 20th century. Now, I want to turn, again, pause just for a quick snapshot at what life was like in the Texas oil patch. And I'm going to turn to another Texas oil patch we saw in the first decade of the 20th century. Oil production would be based in the southeast of Texas, along the Gulf. In the 1930s, another astronomically large oil discovery takes place in East Texas. On October 5th, 1930, after a poor boy driller has been drilling for years, poor boy in the sense that he has limited funds and can only drill in shallow pools, makes a humongous discovery. And there, as you see, this discovery had been predicted by him for quite some time. And in the top four counties, this is the poorest region of the state in amid the what? The Depression of 1930, are sensing that something spectacular is going to arrive. And tradition on Sunday afternoons, of course, was to dress in their Sunday best, leave church, get stuff for a picnic together, and drive out to the well site to see this thing happen. That took a while to happen, but when it did, it was a celebration indeed. It was also a celebration for independent oilmen who discovered that they were sitting on the largest pool ever discovered in the world, 43 miles long, 10 miles wide, containing 5.5 billion barrels. You can imagine what happens next. More jobs, higher incomes, prospering heartland towns. This was the odd circumstance that made East Texas an island during America's decade of depression. For the whole decade, East Texas would be the heart of oil production in the United States, and again, transforming this region with exponential population growth, and again, a celebration, a renewal of the wildcat ethic. So I just want to highlight, again, four kind of elements of what I mean by this wildcat Christianity. A radicalized, if you will, evangelicalism, but one that also includes other elements of Catholicism, for instance, as well. Four elements I want to highlight. First of all, prosperity gospel. Amid the excitement of this gusher age, Texans intensified a spiritual outlook that saw God as the reason for their escape from affliction into a fresh reality of empowerment. Even as they envisioned this providential force, they also embraced the mysteries and curious workings of chance and celebrated the speculative and supernatural dimensions of faith, oil, and the market. Good Christians, they believed, were to spend more energy riding and maximizing the whims of oil than trying to control and discipline them. Several features of this booming landscape, again, lent proof to this new prosperity gospel. Oil's blessedness, blessing the poor with the riches from heaven. Most obvious here, I mean, churches were known to fill their own properties with derricks Number of churches would celebrate these wells coming in. They would, of course, pray over them, sing hymns. And after oil arrived, they would take down their old clapboard church and build Gothic cathedrals. And Gothic was the going style in the 1930s in East Texas. The rise of the wildcat, the big, rich wildcatter, the poor boys turned rich overnight, of course, became almost a cult figure in East Texas at this time. Leading to a political legacy that, again, we'll highlight just briefly in a few minutes. One of them is H.L. Hunt here, pictured with a cigar, Sid Richardson. There's others, of course, that would hit it big and legitimate this kind of prosperity gospel that would be at the heart of the wildcat ethic. So anomalous in America's Depression era, well-financed ministries nevertheless became the expectation for East Texas congregations. Such were the foundations of a prosperity gospel that would permeate the Southwest in decades to come. The windfall of East Texas's lucky citizens also created a second effect, a leveling of class and a rising conviction that plain folk could finally realize their destiny as equals, that the Rockefellers no longer had their grip on them. As one writer offered, here was a democratic opportunity that pushed social and economic frontiers far beyond Adam Smith's wildest dreams. Oil saturated with riches pouring into their offering plates, even, especially, the most marginalized religious folk could enjoy the launch to a new social order. Third, bolstered by the success of their communities, looking to future gains, East Texas church folk nevertheless knew that oil was impermanent. A local captured this sentiment when he titled his memoir, "Where Oil Flows, Joy and Woe Curiously Mingle." Showers of wealth and health today would mean deluge of misfortune tomorrow, he lamented. This was the trade-off of life in an oilscape, where the temporality and frailty of everything and an inevitable future of depletion always clouded the soul. When you strike oil, he said, you let loose Hades. For many East Texans, the trade-offs of their boom generated distinctive eschatological or end times thinking. Theirs was a tenuous existence that encouraged them to assign cosmic purpose to their earthly pursuits, to appreciate life's surprising bursts of health and wealth as a miraculous interlude in an otherwise difficult slide towards cataclysmic end, and pray to an all-powerful being who giveth and taketh suddenly, but who is always there. Theirs was a mentality that defined the post-millennial confidence in the gradual betterment of humanity, Rockefeller's confidence, and accepted the calamities of an apocalyptic mode. And there are, again, examples of this, the way in which certain doctrines become popular in East Texas at this time, premillennialism most notably. There's also experiences of tragedy that are just mind-boggling. And I mentioned this last night. One of the greatest tragedies would take place here in a village in New London, in the heart of East Texas. There, thanks to oil money, the community is able to build a brand new school that is the envy of school boards across the country. In the classrooms is posted kind of a declaration to which all students will look that says, oil and natural gas are East Texas's greatest mineral blessings. Without them, the school would not be here and none of us would be here learning our lessons. Again, underscoring the dependency and the celebration of this resource. In 1937, a janitor or someone working in the shop flicked a light switch and ignited an underground pocket of gas that was being pipelined in from the oil fields to heat. The resulting explosion literally destroyed one of the new buildings. In the next 18 hours, as you see here, oil workers from all over poured in to try to scrape out their children from the rubble. 300 students died. This is one-third of the town's underage population, the largest industrial accident up to, I think, the present, and the reason for adding malodorants to gas. East Texans now lived an eschatological existence where hellacious reversals of fortune, not easy progression to utopian end, were the norm. But rather than dwell on despair, local pastors urged citizens to renew their faith in a Christ who expected them to use whatever prosperity they had in the passing moment to prepare for his return. Surely God is beginning a revival here that is destined to sweep America, pastors charged at memorial services. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Amid the ferment, ferment oil patch citizens absorbed a related truth, that they alone had the courage to stare down end times darkness with uncompromising drive, including in their work. If time is running out, death and an afterlife on the horizon, what is a God-fearing person to do but drill, drill, drill? And if drilling was such an urgent imperative, the question was how best to accomplish the task and to protect the rights to that task. And that leads to the fourth dimension, and this is the political one, and it's one that we'll kind of track quickly through the second half of the 20th century. Those who inhabited the oil patch of East Texas were also filled with a spirit of rebellion, which was present from the beginning due to their marginalization by the Rockefellers. And again, we can chart the growth of lobbies and organizations of these southwestern-based Texas oilmen, independents, who are going to oppose Rockefeller at every stage. Politically as well, they're going to celebrate when Standard Oil is brought to its knees in 1911 and forced to dismantle because it's a monopoly forced by the Supreme Court. But it's really in the 1930s and 40s when their revolt against the Rockefellers and their revolt against Washington and the Roosevelt government is going to intensify and spread and lay the groundwork for a more successful political revolution in the years that follow. Among those of the most hated by them is Secretary of the Interior Harold Ickes, pictured here on the Time magazine. Ickes saw the world in the same way as William Eddy and Nelson Rockefeller, wanted American oil to go international in its exploration, wanted to support the largest companies, they were the most trustworthy in his mind, and wanted to put Washington behind their efforts, all the while trying to rein in the chaotic oil production of East Texas by implementing expensive, especially for small producers, conservation policies, those policies that would provide a greater regulatory structure, one in which, again, independent oilmen especially would find cumbersome and they would decide to fight back. Now, who is going to lead them? It's this individual here, and those who were at the talk yesterday will recall. Surely his face is recognizable. Bushy eyebrows. One senator who didn't like him so much said, J. Howard Pugh not only talks like an affidavit, he looks like one. A very serious gentleman, but he would lead this spirit of rebellion. Comes out of an oil family with a very typical story. His family started Sunoil or Sunoco in the late 19th century, but his dad is basically pushed out of the business by the Rockefellers. And J. Howard Pugh will live with that animus for the rest of his life. And he will decide that he is going to oppose the Rockefellers with all his might in the corporate business, corporate realm, in philanthropy, and in the church. And he is also going to marshal independent oilmen, wildcat Christianity's attack on Washington. And he's going to do so at the start, really at the beginning of the 1930s, and do so straight into the 1940s. He's going to have some victories. We don't have time to get into some of the more important or the most foundational ones. One of them is going to take place in 1945. Harold Ickes, again in his effort, his kind of civil religion of crude, the effort to partner government with big business to spread American influence abroad, is going to be stalled. Ickes is going to propose an Anglo-American petroleum agreement, which will basically bring the British and Americans into partnership to navigate and manage new oil exploration in the Middle East, but thanks to the Pews and independent oilmen who are going to protest this as anti-capitalist in spirit, they're going to say it places Washington at the center of a cartel of multinational companies and makes U.S. interests vulnerable to foreign powers and government meddling at its worst. This is the argument the Pews are going to lobby for, and they're going to win, and ultimately this agreement is going to be dismantled. So that's one victory, and we're going to talk to another one in the next slide. But briefly, even as the politics of this is starting to play out, Pew is also going to form a charitable trust in 1948, Pew Trust, and in his own separate trust within under that canopy established at the same time is going to protest and proclaim that this trust is to acquaint Americans with the values of a free market, the paralyzing effects of government controls, and the independence of Christianity and freedom. A devout Presbyterian, libertarian, and conservative in his beliefs, he sees the Rockefellers, he sees their vision, both in politics and philanthropy, as monopolistic, as secular. They are trying to, break down the essentials of what Pew thinks is evangelical Christianity. And he has decided he is going to support a number of institutions that are going to push back against Rockefeller influence in the church. All right. Post-World War II, how does this play out now politically? And I'm going to emphasize again the politics of this, perhaps at the cost of some of the other dimensions which we can outline. Even as the U.S. is seeing its major oil companies cast its gaze abroad, there's going to be a greater urgency among independent oilmen back in North America to open up domestic fields. They are angry with the way Washington seems to be supporting the big guy abroad instead of their own work. And in the Cold War, they are arguing this is how we protect our national security. Energy independence is absolutely essential. And again, they see this not just in political and economic, but religious terms as well. One of the first turns that is going to be significant to the politics of the South is the Tidelands controversy of the late 40s, early 50s. Again, an episode that historians really haven't treated. If we want to understand how the South turns to the Republican Party, and then how within the Republican Party, conservatives, those based in the Southwest, will take over the party, this is really one of the opening opening battles. The Tidelands controversy arises in the late 40s when President Truman seeks to control 10-mile zones off of offshore oil, whether it's in California or in Texas and Louisiana. Now, prior to this point, this terrain had been leased out by the states to oil companies, especially independent oil companies, who are going to discover oil in the Gulf in 1947. This is lucrative, of course. Much of this money is funneled into public education. So as soon as Truman offers this, decides that the federal government's going to take control, you can imagine what happens. These individuals, these states, are going to fight back. In 1948, they'll fight through the States' Rights Party. And then in 1952, they are going to turn to another presidential candidate by the name of Dwight Eisenhower. By the early 50s, of course, there is an effort to roll back Washington's attempt to take the Tidelands. This isn't just about oil and capitalism, they say. This is about family values. It's the federal government stealing our resources and, moreover, stealing our ability to educate our kids in the way that we see fit. So fuel and family values merge here. There's going to be a coming together, then, of different kind of elements within this wildcat Christian coalition. We're going to see preachers like Billy Graham emerge at this time, kind of the voice of a new emerging evangelicalism that's going to become a force culturally and politically in the post-war period. We're going to see independent oilmen, wildcatters from East Texas like Sid Richardson, J. Howard Pugh, Hugh Cullen, align themselves with Graham, support his ministry, and then as a whole start to lobby for an opponent that can fight back the federal land grab, as they see it, and take back this land for the states. And that is going to be Dwight Eisenhower. Among those who are going to do the lobbying are Sid Richardson and Billy Graham, two of whom will send letters of pleading to Eisenhower to run for the Republican ticket. Eisenhower will decide to do so. He will do so on a platform of returning Tidelands control to the states. And in 52, the Republican Party will win in this region. Now, this will be the first, certainly not the last. There's going to be some fits and starts ahead. But this coming together of different constituents of wildcat Christianity is going to create the first wedge for the Republican Party across the Sun Belt. Briefly, I want to leave some time for questions. The unabashed evangelical politicking of wildcat Christianity both for petroleum, for fuel, and family values would certainly continue. And just a brief snapshot of a couple stages along the way. How does this play out within the Republican Party? Again, the main kind of terrain on which these competing visions, the Rockefeller and the Pew, will wage war for control of this party as well as control of the church and the corporate sector. Well, in 1964, this bloc of wildcat Christianity will throw its support behind Barry Goldwater, whose campaign against whom in the Republican primaries that year? Nelson Rockefeller will animate their struggle. Now, Nelson Rockefeller, of course, will be among the liberal critics who will rail against the extremists on the oil-funded right. But for independent oilmen, churchmen like J. Howard Pugh, there is no question who was on the wrong side of the spectrum. It was Nelson Rockefeller and Nelson Rockefeller Republicans. Besides conjuring up bad memories of one family's near destruction of another's sustenance, Rockefeller also registered with him as the face of a coercive system of centralization and compromise that had long threatened to emasculate his profession and the country's hallowed institutions and beliefs. "I do know much about Nelson Rockefeller," Pugh wrote an ally at this time, "and he would be the worst man that I can think of for president of this country of ours. To put a Republican in as president like Nelson Rockefeller, who supports all the evils that have brought this country to its knees, would be the most tragic thing that could happen." As a result, Pugh proved overly generous in his bankrolling of Goldwater. Goldwater's vanquishing of Nelson Rockefeller in the 1964 GOP primaries gave exceeding pleasure to Pugh and his colleagues. And certainly so did Goldwater's speech at the Cow Palace when accepting the nomination, of course, famously stated, "I would remind you that extremism in the defense of liberty is no vice, and let me remind you also that moderation in the pursuit of justice is no virtue." This is the language of wildcat Christianity resonating in the halls of power. And even though the revolution, as conservatives saw it, would be stalled in 64 with Lyndon Johnson's win, there would be other attempts and other victories yet to come. There would be economic ones as well, and this is what I spent more time on yesterday. I don't have time today. But even as kind of the Goldwater rebellion within the Republican Party was being generated by the likes of Pugh, Pugh was also active in creating new economic frontiers for independent oil as well. These independents of Texas and Oklahoma were certainly moving into the Gulf of Mexico. This is one of their domestic terrains where they could explore successfully, gain profits, build companies, and support the cultural institutions of their choosing. Another would be Alberta, which of course comes online in 1947 with the Leduc oil strike, making Alberta also a destination of choice for these types. J. Howard Pugh would be influential in a second initiative in Alberta, and that is in 1952 when he decided to invest in the oil sands, create the Great Canadian Oil Sands. He would do so in partnership with Ernest Manning, his good friend and fellow evangelical, with whom he would share sermons and Bible verses. And in that friendship, Pugh would decide to invest $250 million in the startup of Great Canadian Oil Sands. As I said yesterday, this was the largest private investment in Canada at that point. Now, the oil sands would take some time to develop through the 50s and early 60s. There would be some hitches along the way, but the partnership of Manning and Pugh would stand firm. Manning would preach across the Southwest. He would preach at wildcat independent oil associations during the week, then churches, evangelical churches on Sundays. He was a hero to many down there. Which is why he celebrated the fact quite openly that Alberta had become the Texas of Canada. This is kind of the north-south axis now of power that is being forwarded, advanced in part by projects like the Great Canadian Oil Sands, which opens officially in 1967. The 1970s would bring a certain crescendo to this constituency and its politics as well. Richard Nixon would rely on this same system of support to win his victory in 68 and 72. Nixon's vision was, like Goldwater and Reagan's, tightly attuned to the religious topography of the oil patch. Through his ties to Billy Graham and Sunbelt Ministries, he gained access to the aspirations of an ascendant force that would eventually redefine the American political landscape. He used this alliance as leverage during the 70s energy crisis, early 70s energy crisis. While the Northeast shivered in the cold and endured gas lines, he and his oil patch constituents mocked environmentalists and Northern Liberal Democrats and Republican Rockefeller Republicans. Save energy, let a Yankee freeze in the dark. Versions of the bumper sticker could be found in church parking lots throughout Texas and Oklahoma. More broadly, the energy crises of the 70s would empower a Southwestern-based evangelical movement, the beating heart of wildcat Christianity. On one hand, the global ruptures of the decade and the struggles of major oil companies to handle OPEC and the quest by Arab oil-producing countries to nationalize their oil industries undermined the multinational corporations and ultimately the civil religion of crude that the Rockefellers had long stood for. On the other, the prosperity gospel and eschatology of crisis that had captured the Southwestern oil patch mindset in the 30s now bloomed on a national stage, propelling the evangelical phenomenon as a whole into the national consciousness. Note, for instance, Newsweek magazine proclaiming 1976 the year of the evangelical. Or also the work and success of ministries like Oral Roberts based in the oil capital of Tulsa. Evangelicals purchased books that pinned the energy crisis on U.S. reliance on Muslim-controlled Middle Eastern oil, reliance created by the Rockefellers and their cadre in major oil, and prophesied that the end of the world was imminent, in part because Washington had forsaken the interests and values of independent oil. Among the most popular author of such books was John Walvoord. From his professorship at Dallas Theological Seminary, Walvoord wrote for a sprawling national audience. His 1970s text, Armageddon, Oil in the Middle East Crisis, reached millions of readers. In it, he channeled his end times angst against environmentalists who had made America dependent on non-Christian others. Were Americans able to tap freely the bountiful oil pools just off the Gulf Coast and in Alaska, underneath southwestern soil and in the shale deposits of Colorado, he asserted they would realize anew peace, security, and the natural order of things. This was the millennial splendor promised by God in black gold, and it was time in his mind for politicians and presidents to take it seriously. Pairing premillennialist understandings of time with fears of peak oil, Arab, Muslim, control of foreign oil, and the threat to Israel, and the decline of American power, evangelicals in the Southwest oil and church associations forcefully sold the message that it was the patriotic independence of the U.S. oil patch that could save America from its dependency on foreigners and from its slide into godlessness. Wildcatting oil's warriors did not just want revival, they wanted to bring their political revolution to fruition as well and to ensure that their fuel and family values won the White House. Jimmy Carter would feel the effects of that ambition. To be sure, and as historians have written about at length, the evangelical-led Reagan Revolution of 1980 was animated by social concerns. Carter's support of the Equal Rights Amendment and women's rights did not sit well with evangelicalism's rising class of culture warriors. And while they once cheered him as one of their own, by 1979, they saw him as a liberal and a Democrat whose evangelical credentials were now soft. Independent oilmen were among those who took up the fight for social conservatism. With J. Howard Pugh now deceased, it was up to other wildcatters to bankroll the cause. One of the biggest boosters was the Hunt family of East Texas, H.L. Hunt, again, a legacy of the 1930s. H.L.'s son, Bunker, was unmatched in his giving. He endorsed Bill Bright's Campus Crusade for Christ, which proposed a $1 billion venture to proselytize youth, and sponsored Christian apologist Francis Schaeffer, whose 1979 manifesto, Whatever Happened to the Human Race, sparked evangelicals' anti-abortion crusade. But nothing triggered Hunt and his peers' rage more than Carter's energy politics. The president's support of the ERA and abortion rights infuriated them. But Carter's crisis of confidence speech was equally damning in their eyes. In this dour homily, Carter bemoaned the nation's high energy consumption and lack of conservation. The attack on oil, made not only in economic but in moral terms, was the final straw for the wildcatters. Over the course of the next year, Republican candidate Ronald Reagan inflamed their anger with his hard-driving quest for the presidency. Running on the slogan, "Let's make America great again," Reagan won the hearts and minds of the American oil patch. "We must remove government obstacles to energy production," he declared when he announced his candidacy. "It is no program simply to say use less energy." Malaise had no place in Reagan's vocabulary. Exuding an audacity that the oil patch embraced, he traveled to Texas and mingled with preachers and petroleum kings, promising them that the nation would be great again as soon as Washington bureaucrats let rugged wildcatters open up new frontiers of extractive wealth and God-fearing pioneers raise their children in communities calibrated to the morals of an honorable past. In the pulpits and pews of the Southwest, Reagan's calls for Washington to protect local oil producers' rights to drill, drill, drill was a potent and effective rallying cry. The institutional structures of Wildcat Christianity, its oil-funded megachurches, schools like Oral Roberts, and pastors like Billy Graham, would indeed welcome and amplify Reagan's fuel and family values message and prove critical to his electoral victory in 1980. And Reagan would reward his supporters by making one of them his Secretary of the Interior. In that role, premillennialist Pentecostal oil lobbyist James Watt, pictured here before you, would see to it that evangelicals' longstanding fears of federal encroachment on land and resources would find clear policy outlets. And in the spirit of the Southwest wildcatters who had begun their fight against the New Deal order by confronting an interior secretary, Harold Ickes, of a very different ilk, he would promise to restore custodianship of the oil patch to the people who had long worked it as theirs. Although Watt's career in Washington would be short, the Wildcat Revolt he helped solidify would continue to strengthen in the 1980s and beyond right to today. Each step forward for Wildcat Republicans would mean a step back for the dreams of men like William Eddy. Rising frustrations with OPEC and its own claims to crude as God-given, festering worry about liberal drifts in energy policy, heightened tensions with Aramco and Middle Eastern petroleum suppliers with whom William Eddy had befriended, and suspicions that America's turn to foreign oil in 1940 was at the root of the shortages of the 1970s intensified an anxiety that the GOP's new elite used to undermine the Rockefeller vision. By the 1980s, with Saudi Arabia's sole owner now of Aramco and the company's morale groups and moral alliance disbanded, and Arabist ecumenists of William Eddy's generation dead or dying, one could say that Henry Luce's American century and its twin pillars of beneficent oil and internationalist religion had succumbed. Today is very clear that the exceptional authority Luce proclaimed for his carbon-rich country is no longer America's to enjoy alone. Major oil's ambassadors who went out into the world to educate peoples in the fantastic possibilities of the black stuff helped spur other theologies of oil's blessedness, other myths of exceptionalism that are now replying from abroad. Meanwhile, one can look at recent and current trends in U.S. politics and conclude that the wildcatters have won. There's certainly some indications of this from George W. Bush to Sarah Palin. George W. Bush, of course, being a wildcatter in his own right. A 2016 New York Times article found that 158 families had provided nearly half of early money for GOP candidates to capture the White House. Many of them, numerous, were latter-day wildcatters, in the words of the New York Times, many of whom were involved in fracking. And of course, in the most recent, our current administration, there is other evidence that the wildcat ethic has succeeded. In a recent West Texas swing, Mike Pence headlined fundraising dinners in Dallas and Midland. Filling seats in Trump victory coffers were independent oilmen such as Cal Stallings, whose career started with Hunt Energy in 1979, and West Texas evangelical wildcatter Tim Dunn. "We're putting America energy first," Pence proclaimed in Midland while touring an independent energy company's new rig. With echoes of Reagan in 1980, he heralded the three pillars of American greatness: faith, freedom, and vast natural resources, and promised that developing the vast natural God-given resources that we have, his words, will make America great again. In a familiar refrain, one that J. Howard Pugh and his peers in 1930s East Texas, it is a refrain that they would recognize. At the same time, the picture of the oil patch as static is also misleading. As much as I've emphasized two of the 20th century's carbon gospels, other oil patch gospels have acquired authority and created legacies as well. Recent battles over energy and environment, which you're well familiar with, have exposed dissent within oil patches over the efficacy of the wildcat imperative. At odds are stalwarts of the old order and young dissenters who demand a different, quote, handling of God's garden. One young evangelist, pictured in this group here at the top, one evangelist for the carbon-free gospel states it simply, quote, many people see the pipeline as a political or an economic issue, but I see it as a moral issue. In yet another ironic twist, as we look at protests against the Keystone and the oil sands that have generated its own kind of moral fervor, in another twist, joining the Rockefeller Trust's funding of anti-Alberta oil sands, of course we know is one of the leading funders of this, is the Pew Charitable Trust, the proud creation of J. Howard Pew. The Great Canadian Oil Sands Project is now under attack from another of his institutional legacies. Finally, as much as Wildcat religion continues to possess the pulpits and pews of the American oil patch, in some Texas and Oklahoma churches where fracking permeates vernacular speech, oil's effects on spiritual health are being debated and decried. Is oil and gas truly of God, they ask. Regardless of what side Americans in current pipeline and energy politics, which side they fall on, one thing remains consistent with the past. And it is a dynamic that President Jimmy Carter rightly perceived and noted in his 1979 speech, that energy debates in this country are as embedded and animated by competing worldviews of the here and now and thereafter as they are by sheer economics, and that for combatants across the spectrum, waging them is the moral equivalent of war. Thank you, and I think we still have some time for questions. So.
Thank you, Darren. This is the first time I think we've had a walkable wireless mic in here. So I think the process we'll use is I'll just wander the floor with the mic. And Darren and I can both kind of look for hands. But the floor is open for questions. So any comments, questions, and I'll bring the mic to you. I'll start over here.
Oh, what a sad story you have told. Seeing how oil, whether it's Rockefeller's or Pew's, have co-opted the religious right, I don't see any distribution of all this huge wealth from the oil industry. It was kept in narrower and smaller hands. It has not fueled anything. Sure, they may have built a few schools, paid off a few ministers. How the religious right or any person who is not benefiting from this wealth can continue supporting this kind of propaganda that has been used to allow these incredibly rich people to get even richer is beyond me. Just a comment I want.
No, that's certainly a valid comment. I'm trying to demonstrate that. I mean, obviously others, some within the oil industry that I've just highlighted here would contest that to a degree. And you know, I mentioned a couple just at the end, Tim Dunn, for instance. I mean, they have indeed poured their riches into causes that they see as constructive and valid. And so where we might, or some might see it as coercive, and dark in their estimation, this is the response to the darkness, and it has created what I would emphasize is just a vast cultural, institutional, political structure that is impenetrable right now, and especially across the Southwest, and it extends beyond politics is the point. I mean, it extends to global missions and so forth, and in their eyes, in their estimation, this is not just valid, it is necessitated, and it's been necessitated by their own place within American society going back to the early 20th century. So, I've underestimated today, too, the degree to which there has been contestation, the degree to which there have been morally charged kind of individuals and groups who have even within the oil patch itself, many young people, for instance, joining 350 org, or seeing the structures of power in which they've grown up, in which they've worshipped, and resisting that. So there's more at play, more going on. I've done my best to simplify with just one dramatic tension, if you will, and it's up to you to decide if it's dramatic or not. Attention in this story.
Thank you for your presentation.
Oh.
Is there a link, and to what extent is the link between Wildcat Christianity and the NRA?
And the NRA? Oh, Now we're going God, oil, and guns. I mean, that's, you know, there, I don't know, I'm sure there's a lot. I cannot verify that through my own research. And, but the culture of both map onto each other, I think, quite easily. And if you want to talk regionally, if you want to talk just a certain, again, worldview, I think you could safely say those two are very much wedded. So, but that'll have to be up to someone else to research. I had actually thought of writing my next book on religion and guns, and my wife said, don't you dare, so.
Just a comment, an observation. We were on a cruise a couple of years, just after Trump got elected, and sitting with a lady who was very much a Trump supporter, and she was, yeah, you know, Hillary's going to jail and all that stuff. And she says, well, he's not perfect. And I said, well, who would have been better? I said, would you have voted for Bernie Sanders? Because she hated Hillary. Mm-hmm. She said, oh, Lord, no. She said, all he wants to do is take our money and give it to somebody who hasn't worked, who right. doesn't want to work.
Right.
And that fits into this, why they're not, the poor keep getting poorer. If you've worked in there, you get the money, and right. God loves you.
Right. No, it's you're right, and it's a again, we can't underestimate. I'm trying to offer some deeper historical roots to this mentality, and it is in the soil, quite literally in the soil of a vast region of the country, and it's the West, it's the Southwest, it's Alaska, you know, Sarah Palin's home, and so I would hope people after reading the book will understand that a bit better and appreciate it as well, and you know they've had their own. You know, we look at the big rich within that, and that exaggerates. But even the average workers within the oil patch, within that culture, and I think you could see that in Alberta, they kind of they take in this mythology as well, right? I mean, oil, whether you're super rich or a roughneck, you can make some pretty good money. And, you know, so that the logic of this actually isn't necessarily running against this kind of belief system that I have just highlighted for you. So, but the woman you talked to is certainly emblematic of.
From Oklahoma too.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, no. I mean, that's like a stereotype. I mean, you don't even have to. I mean, it's Oklahoma, it's Texas, and it's not just those two. But you know, look, I don't want to draw Alberta equals with Alberta, but you know, I heard the same kind of rhetoric in the 80s. I mean, if you want to talk about Ottawa, you want to talk about someone stealing our resources that we should have possession of and manage and allow it to shape our own cultural institutions, our churches, and the way we see fit. I mean, that's not so out of sorts.
I just want to add something else. Peter Lougheed, let the Eastern bastards freeze in the dark.
Yeah, exactly. That was a bumper sticker up here, too. And the other bumper sticker, of course, is what is it, some variants of, you know, God, please give us another boom this time. We won't blow it away or something. I mean, that's the same kind of mentality. This is like this just violent cycles of boom bust, which never seem to end. But it also doesn't concern a lot of people in Oklahoma, Texas. It's just the natural way of life. And hopefully God will give us another crack at it. So
I see these hands. We'll get to you. I want to make sure there's a class here. Any students, if you have a question, comment. I see one. We'll give the students a chance to speak as well.
Sorry, I've just, I've never heard the term wildcatter or wildcat Christianity used before. Is there any way you could, like, I guess simplify it to layman's terms, mostly because I'm writing a summarization for this.
So. Yeah, I'm the one who coined the term wildcat Christianity. I kind of like it. But yeah, right. So, you know, as I emphasized today, I mean, at the heart of it is kind of a radical evangelicalism, right? A very kind of emphasis on individual freedom, the freedom to approach God and the Bible on one's own terms, to realize salvation on those terms, and seeing that as a way to transform society. The reason I use wildcat Christianity, A, because it speaks to who the leaders within this culture were, and these were wildcatters, they're independents, or who are charged with opening up new terrain, putting down wildcat wells, all right? So that they're risk-taking, it's highly speculative, it's dangerous, but they're willing to take that on in a way that the Rockefellers and major companies aren't, right? And so there's a certain fierce independence of this that creates a different culture. It's also a term that I use because, you know, when you're looking at the Southwest, it's predominantly evangelical, but you also have a number of Catholics, Catholic oilmen, who are espousing the same kind of fierce independence in their business and in the church. William F. Buckley Sr., whose son, William F. Buckley Jr., will be a very key intellectual in the rise of the conservative movement in the 50s. Well, his father, Sr., was, again, just a rabid independent oilman who hated the Rockefellers, hated the majors, a very devout Catholic as well. So that term was a slightly broader umbrella, allowing me to bring in other religious persuasions as well. I hope that helps. Yeah.
Is that idea of the snake where it was associated with Rockefeller, which is a good association, but he is the Tides Fund, so we're associating the Tides Fund to the snake. But my question is it involved in government? Is the Tides Foundation part of the federal government, would you say? I know it's like a foundation, but would you say it's really part of
the Rockefeller or the Tides?
The Tides Foundation.
Well, yeah, okay, so this is an octopus, and as those of you who've studied U.S. history around 1900, that was a symbol of Rockefeller power, right? The octopus of big business, and not coincidentally, they applied that same critique to big government over the Tidelands issue. And so the octopus is Washington, and big business and big government now are wedded as the twin evils in American society. And so they need to slay the octopus on both.
Okay, but they're not as one. They're just intertwined, like big. See, because
right,
Christianity
right.
can also be intertwined with government, as it should
be. Oh, sure.
You know, and intertwining is good. I think when you get to Islam and they make it one, Christianity and government, like their religion and government is one, that's bad. Because you need to be able to sever the octopus, like sever Tidelands from the federal government. And if you have such a government that it's part of the government, you have to destroy the government to destroy Tide. But in this case, you don't.
Well, like no, it's an entwinement. But I would also, and I'll just leave it at this. I mean, there are some comparisons to make. Look, I'm talking about, yes, separation, you know, in North America of religion and government is a good thing, whatever. But I'm suggesting that divide isn't so clear here either, and that if you're living in Texas, Oklahoma, it's not about separating yourself from government but controlling it. And in some ways, oil patches are eschatological. I would suggest they're theocratic in a way too. I mean, there is a certain power structure that's not so different from what you see in other parts of the world. So. But your point's a good one. So
okay, just one more comment. See, when I hear you say about the that guy who said we have a lack of confidence in our country, I think the lack of confidence is in Christianity, where if you had the confidence in Christ, you would, you know, not have Tidelands. You know, the octopus coming into the snake. But you know what's really interesting is that it's always been like that. Like, as I'm going to be interested in reading your book, because I think it goes back to whether it's the, you know, 17th century, 18th, or the 18th century. No, it started 1890 oil. So the 19th century, 20th, you know, both centuries, it's been the same fight. It's like good and evil. Evil rises, good rises, you know. So I think confidence in Christianity is really good. And I liked your comment on moral. Oil is moral. You know, on one hand, the socialists, they say, oh, you want to make everyone's life better. Hey, oil makes everyone's life better. Mm-hmm. So don't shut down oil and then spout on the other side, oh, we're here to make your life better.
No,
it's a contradiction.
Well, exactly. That is at the heart of the book itself, too. I am in no way, I'm not, as again, we talked yesterday, but I'm a historian. I, to a fault, I see the grays rather than the black and whites. And I don't have strong opinions because I see the mess of it all. And the book tries to show that, and it shows also on this very point. Look, I mean, you know, the anti-oil activists are coming at this perhaps from the periphery. They don't understand how important it is to this material form is to the lifeblood of a community, of a region like this one. And my book is trying to show not the entanglements, but just how organic this is, and it affects how we play and work and worship. And so to expect someone to extract themselves from that reality easily and quickly, as many protesters would suggest, is false thinking. At the same time, those within the proximity to this can blind you too, I think, to larger challenges that we all face environmentally and so forth. So I think, you know, it's requiring, I hope, everyone to try to understand this and the difficulties of coming to terms with it in more textured detail. So
I can't talk very well, so just bear with me. I heard today about the sins of these rich people and what have they given us. I look at other countries that don't have oil, that are not developed. They're going along behind an ox with a stick, yeah, working their land.
Yeah.
I farm. I wouldn't want to work without diesel fuel.
Right.
And also, talking about renewable resources, that they got a long ways to go. I don't think anybody in this room will live long enough to see the freight train going through the Rocky Mountains pulling oil or coal or wood or grain or anything running on anything other than nuclear power or fossil,
mm-hmm,
fuels.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so anyway, and also the Rockefellers and the Pews, how they've, now they're fighting against what they created. I believe they were walking with God when they started. Now the younger generation, same as here, are falling away. Mm-hmm. When this country was built, Alberta was developed, first thing popped up was small churches. Now people say, well, I don't have time for God.
Mm-hmm.
Well, God is going to punish us.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you, yeah. No, those are good insights, and I didn't have time. You know, when I talked about this Rockefeller way, I mean, and it's in terms of the Pews, too. I mean, we to see on a global scale what oil allowed the Rockefeller Foundation to do, to spread science, technology, medicine to Asia, to South America, and you know, as I said, Aramco was envisioned in that way. We are going to draw oil out of the ground, but we're going to do so in an effort also to provide you with other amenities of modernity. We're going to bring water. We are going to help you build your community. So again, it's all open to critique. At the same time, the bottom line is oil money did a lot of good. It did a lot of things to kind of improve the lifestyles of people around the world, and in those communities where that hasn't happened, of course. So again, I don't have strong, all I would like us to do is see also the degree to which oil-funded philanthropy has also created its own international apparatus of human kind of social uplift. And, you know, I don't really have comment for the latter comment that you made, but it's all valid. Thank you.
We have time for a couple more, and it's a student hand here, so.
Do you believe that the choice to make oil and religion, that religion and oil became so entwined just because they happened to be evangelical, or is it more of a insidious kind of like choice to be like, all right, well, let's tie this to person's identity, and then it's harder to get rid of the need for oil? And then, mm-hmm, I have a second part to that.
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, again, my point, and this isn't a cop-out, but as a historian, I'm just trying to show organically, and I didn't, there's many different motivations and interests in play here, and I don't deny those. I don't deny the legitimacy of these, the ways in which organizations are co-opted by one side or the other for their own gain or their own personal profit. I try to show that in full relief in the book. At the same time, the more important point I'm trying to make is that it's almost an impossible question to decipher so easily what's coming first. Is this a true religious conviction? Or I am suggesting that within the particular if you want to say, capitalist kind of ethos and structures of that particular sector and the communities that grow up around them, it makes sense to understand the world in those terms. And so I'm not trying to disentangle as much as I'm trying to show them in a complex whole.
Also, do you believe the lack of faith in the oil industry, well, not believe, but could you contribute the lack of the oil and faith in the oil industry to the rise of atheism as well as other religions that are starting to become more widely accepted compared to like the predominant Christian religion?
So you're connecting the critique and doubts about oil to secularization? Well, again, I don't really. Yeah, that's a good question. I'll have to think about that. I don't have a clear answer to that. I think it very clearly amounts to what side you already find yourself on in the debates. I mean, Pew, as I said yesterday, looked at Rockefeller and thought Rockefeller was secular and wasn't a Christian. But if you look at Rockefeller, both Senior, Junior, and his sons, Junior especially was very devout in his Christianity. He was not secular. So, you know, again, I don't think the divide is easy to map out. You can look at perhaps, you know, environmentalists, and you might see a different approach that doesn't resonate with your particular definition of Christianity. But many within the movement would argue the opposite and say, no, in fact, we are bringing a true belief, a true groundedness in the theology of scriptures, of land care to espouse our certain politics. So,
I think that's actually a good place to wrap up. It's a complicated entanglement, for sure. And Darren, in his work, of any historian who has worked on this, has dived into that entanglement further than anyone else I know. So we should congratulate him on that and thank him one more time for speaking with us. Thank you.